Good afternoon, AO National. Glad to have you all here today for our Thursday afternoon training. When I said Thursday, I meant Tuesday. It's all the same to me, okay? So we're going to dive into training today. Today, we're going to be training on Policy Owner Service, known as POS. So for those of you that are brand new, you may have never actually worked a POS before, but you will in the future. So you'll want to write these down. Make sure you grab a pen, paper, take some notes, because a POS presentation, although it's very similar to a regular presentation with a referral or a union, McGruff, et cetera, it has a few key differences. And I want to arm you guys with ammo so that you know what to do when you get in front of a POS. Okay. So first and foremost, I want you to remember the words. When you write down POS, write down policy owner service. Now, sometimes we get confused and we think it means policy owner sale. I assure you it's policy owner service. So the number one thing that you want to think about when you're seeing a POS is you want to remember that it's service first. Your job is to provide a service to the client first, and it's through good service that we get to a sale, okay? So policy owner service. So policy owner service, the great news about this kind of presentation is that these are people, and I'll give you the kind of the behind the scenes of why people like working POS. One, they're proven buyers, because a POS is someone who already has a policy through American Income Life. So they're proven buyers. Two, they're proven payers. They've been paying their policies. That's why they're still a POS. So we know that when you sell one, they're typically a retention booster. They're good for quality of business, and we know they're going to keep their policies. And three, you don't have to resell them on why the products are good, because they already believe in the products. It's just a matter of filling any gaps that they may have, okay? So they're a great lead, a great resource. Typically, they are reserved for agents that have been here for a little while and are very experienced. And the reason for that is that we want to keep the clients that we have. We want to make sure they're happy. We want to make sure they're taken care of. So it only makes sense to have the people that are a little more seasoned, the best of the best working them. But that's why I want to make sure each and every one of you can learn some of these things early on, so you can get to a point where you can work POS as well and help preserve the reputation of the company and moving forward to obviously create sales and income for yourself through servicing POSs. Okay. So that's one of the reasons why they're good. And again, they're also great because POSs a lot of the times know other POSs, because they have referred through the years people that have also become policyholders. So it's very easy to move from one POS presentation to another POS presentation and just kind of continue to keep the ball rolling there. Okay. But it's service over anything else is number one. Okay. All right. So when you're sitting down with a POS, the great news is you can pretty much follow the script that you're all used to using already. You can go through it in the exact same order, all the no-cost benefits, needs analysis, and go through right to the end of presenting all the types of insurances. There is a few key differences though. It's really the start and how you close. And my topic today, what I want to talk to you about, POS angles. And what I mean by angles is you should always prepare for a POS presentation knowing what they have and what you think you're probably going to advise them, okay? When we go into a regular presentation with, say, a referral, we don't know what they have. So through the needs analysis, we figure that out. And then based on that, we make a recommendation based on what the needs analysis in the computer shows us. With a POS, it's neat because we already know what they have in advance of going to see them. So it's easier to kind of figure out through experience and through using the tools like HP Pro and the needs analysis, it's easier to figure out what they're going to need and to make a stronger recommendation. But you always want to prepare. So write that down. Prepare for your POSs. Don't just show up and hope for the best. Prepare for them in advance, but also understand that even the best preparation doesn't mean that they're not going to send you a curveball or it's not going to be a surprise. Okay. But prepare for them. You can look up all the POS appointments you have. You're going to have a summary of what they already have. So it's important that you learn how to read that summary. If you're not sure, ask your manager well in advance of your appointment, and you can always look them up on mPlanet. Again, ask your manager what that means if you're not already sure. Okay. You can always look them up so you know in advance and you're going in with some sort of preparation, but I do not want this to deter you from doing an immediate sit on a POS, because all you need is like 2 minutes. You don't need 20 minutes. You don't need 3 hours. When you practice this enough time, you'll get pretty good at figuring out what people need just by taking a glance at it. And that's why knowing the angles that you can approach a POS set is actually very, very helpful. Okay. So you start your POS presentation, intro will be a little bit different. The reasons you're there will be a little bit different. But other than that, I would encourage you to stick to the script as much as you can. And the only difference is when you're doing a POS, instead of saying, this is your family information guide, or this is your AD&D certificate, and just explaining it, add in the words. You probably remember your AD&D certificate. Let me go over it with you again and then follow the script. You probably remember your family information guide. Let me go over it with you again. We'll get a new copy filled up. So you're doing the same thing, but you're just reminding them and seeing what if they remember. If they don't, perfect. Say the script as per normal. If they do, no problem. I'm going to walk you through it again. We're going to get this updated for it. So all you're doing is the update on the same thing. You probably remember the McGruff kit, John. You do. Okay, great. And then back to the script. Here's a reminder. So you don't have to do a whole lot of changes in how you're presenting or learn anything kind of fancy or new other than remembering that, just to ask if they've already seen it or it's a reminder for them. Okay. And then you walk through that presentation. So when you're going through, you're going to get to the referral part. This is not a referral POS training, but I want to make clear that it is just as easy, if not easier, to get referrals from a POS as it is anybody else, as long as you're asking correctly. And I would really encourage you to follow the script. Okay. Don't try to be fancy or special just because it's a POS. Either they give you the referrals naturally, or they might say something like, we did this last year. And that's when you say, yes, John, no kidding, right? You're actually, because you're a policy owner, you get the opportunity to extend this to new families every single year. So we're going to start with your family. Then we're going to move to your friends and we're going to go to coworkers. And then you just do it the exact same way. And either they want to give you the same family as last year, or different family, doesn't matter, but you don't need to be fancy with POS, okay? Another really easy tip on getting referrals from POS is go for those emergency contacts. So you can always say to them, hey, we don't have any emergency contacts on your file. Who would be a few people that you would want contacted in the event that something happens and you actually need to use this insurance? And get them down and then tell them, I'm going to call these people. I'm going to review your coverage with them so they know you have it. And they're also going to get an opportunity to get all of your no-cost benefits and see some options for themselves. Sound good? Think about it. If it's a POS and they like what they bought, are they really going to be opposed to you showing that to their family? They're not going to be. They're going to be happy with that. And it makes sense to tell them, I'm going to call them to review what you have. If they're on your emergency contact list, I'm going to call them, let them know what you have and let them know they're one of your emergency contacts. And at the same time, they're going to get all your no-cost stuff and options for themselves. So not to worry, we'll get them taken care of too. If they like us enough and they like what we have enough that they wanted to buy our products, they're going to be more than happy for their family and friends to want them too. So capitalize on that. But outside of that, you don't really need to do anything crazy to get referrals from POS. It's pretty natural. The other one you're going to get is they're already policy holders. And that's when you say, that's perfect. Let me take down their information again. We'll connect with them to make sure they get their annual updates done as well and they don't get missed. Very simple. Okay. And that way you're collecting referral. It's a beautiful way to do it. And how cool is it knowing that you're jumping from one policyholder to the next, to the next, to the next? Simple. Okay. So let's move forward. So what I really want to talk about is the angles on POS. So you get through the whole first half, you explain the no-cost benefits, you've gotten your referrals, you set it up all the same way as you would with any other presentation. Now you're at the second half where you're going to do the needs analysis and you're going to put everything through. So this time we already know what they have. So you can take the information from your POS sheet, you can throw it into the needs analysis. And the only thing you need to do is confirm if they haven't added anything extra with any other companies. So you really know what they're looking at. You can still use the needs analysis to do a POS, and you can present it to them exactly as it shows on the screen, because it's unlikely. And when I say unlikely, almost never is it that a POS has everything fully taken care of. A lot of the times people don't pick the highest option, or even if they do, now they're older, now they have a family, now their income has gone up, now they need more. That's natural that people have to add to their insurance over time. So don't let that be a concern you. There's likely a gap no matter what. But here's the angles that I'm going to talk to you about today. I'm going to tell them all to you first, and then I'll tell you kind of how to do each one. Okay. So the angles you want to approach a POS set to make a sale, this is past the service part. And just to back up for a second, make sure that in that first half, the other thing you want to add in after you do referrals, all that kind of stuff too, you want to make sure that they don't need help with any claims or filling out any paperwork. Like if they have an A71, have they been in the hospital? Obviously if it's a death claim, they wouldn't be sitting there with you. So probably not that, but is there anything up address updates, anything like that, that they need help with, leaning on the service side? Don't take an hour to do it, but a quick two minute conversation, get it done, direct them in the right place. You're good to go. Okay. And that way they really do feel like it's a service. They don't just feel like you're there to sell them more insurance. And that's sometimes a common objection you'll get when you book a POS is they'll say, oh, every time someone calls, they just want to sell me more. And I always say, well, hey, John, if you need more, I'm going to be honest and tell you that. But my job is to service your policy, do that review. And either way, you'll know by the end of our meeting where you stand. sound good? And that way they know you're not just trying to sell them something for nothing. But if they do need more, then you're going to sell them more and you're going to be honest that they need it. If they don't want to buy it, that's really up to them. Okay. I know I've had questions about, do you show them how to access the self-service portal? Sure. You totally can send them the link. I just don't spend a lot of time on anything I do in a presentation. So if it's going to take me 15 minutes to show them, I'm probably not. I'm going to send them the link and I'm going to say, figure it out. Let me know if you have any questions. Okay. Same with anything else. I'm not going to overkill on time because remember, these are also policyholders that they remember how long their first presentation was. They don't really want to spend another hour and a half with you every year, right? They're hoping the follow-up is quicker. So your POS presentation shouldn't take you 2 hours to do because again, they've already seen some of this. You're buzzing through it a little more quickly. So don't spend too much time. Okay. Don't cut them short on things that they have questions about, but don't overkill either. They might remember things from before. Okay. So now here's the angles. If you want to write these ones down. So the angles are this. One is not matching or opposite coverages. Okay. So if you want to write that down, coverages don't match, as in the spouses do not have the same coverage or they have the opposite of what they should have. For example, the older person has less coverage than the younger person, something like that. Okay. That's angle number one. Angle number two is holes or gaps. And all that really means is they're missing coverage. Maybe they have no paycheck protection at all. So they have a gap in their benefits. The third one is they're not covered for inflation. So the benefits are not inflation proof. Okay. Number four is they're currently on a pay for life plan. It's not fully paid up. Okay. And the last one is they just have a basic plan. They must've started with a basic plan and now it's time to do an upgrade. Okay. So let me back through those. We'll start with the not matching and opposite. So the reason I say prepare is you want to go in with an angle, and the angle can't be, I want to sell you more. There has to be a reason why you're making the recommendation that you are. Okay. So when I look at it, if I look at, say there's a spouse, two spouses there and what they're close to the same age. Like if they're within like a 10 year gap, they should have pretty similar coverage. If they're 30 years apart. Okay. I get it. Why one has more, one has less, but if they're within kind of a few years of each other, in age, there should be no reason why one has 30 grand of permanent coverage and one has 5. Doesn't make sense, right? So that's what I address. So if that's my angle that I'm going in at, that's what I would say. So when I get to the part where I'm going to explain the insurance to them, rather than just going through everything again, I always review what they have first. So I'll go through their freedom of choice. And this time, rather than presenting it like what they will give you is, I'll say, John, you currently have $12,500 on your freedom of choice. So the way this works is, and I kind of follow the script, you have a 2-year paycheck protection worth this much. The way this works is, and I go through it and I ask them, does that make sense? Do they have any questions about what they have? If they do, answer them, okay? But when you're after that, that's when you go into what they actually need. And the key line I use is this. I'll say, so John, so that's what you have. You understand what you have, everything there. Okay, that's great. So one of the reasons your policy was flagged, I always say it, one of your reasons your policy was flagged is dot, dot, dot. And that's one of these angles. So John, one of the reasons that your policy was flagged is it looks like you guys, your coverages don't match. And they'll say, well, what do you mean? I'll say, well, John, you have 10,000 and Mary, you have 40,000 and you guys are only 2 years apart. Like, do you remember why you guys did that? And a lot of the times my follow-up is, do you remember why you did that? It's important to understand why they made the decision. The most common answer is, that's what the guy showed us. Okay. Or they'll go, I don't know. I don't remember. Or they will have a reason. Maybe the reason John has so much less is because he has a policy outside of American Income Life and Mary had no insurance. But whatever the reason is, figure that reason out so you know if the angle you're choosing makes sense. Okay. But if I was to say you don't have matching, I would say, yeah. So one of the reasons your policy was flagged is your coverages don't match. So John, you only have 10, Mary, you have 40. So not to worry. What I'm going to help you with today is to make sure we can get you guys a little bit more even, because obviously we don't want to have that discrepancy. Does that make sense? So I'm already basically saying you're going to get more insurance. Okay. And I'm using a tie down. Does that make sense? And then I do the takeaway. So I'll say, now that being said though, John and Mary, before we move ahead, has your health changed a whole lot since you originally set this up? Okay. because they have to know they have to requalify for it and the health matters. So when I ask that question, what it does is it diverts them away from saying whether or not they want to buy more, and it gets them thinking about whether they even can get more. And if they say, no, it's okay, or yeah, now I have high blood pressure, I'm like, okay, and I'm making notes of this, and I'll say, okay, well, obviously you have to qualify, but provided that you do for the upgrade, let me show you the numbers of what this would look like. And then just do the quick math. Hop onto your HP Pro. You guys know on HP Pro 3 now, it's actually great because you can show three different options at the same time, which works out perfect for a POS, because I always like to work POS in the fashion where I show what I call a gold, silver, or bronze program. So you can just make your programs gold, silver, or bronze, show all three at once, and then they can just pick one. Okay, so I'll get into kind of how I present that, but HP Pro 3 does give you the option to show three different plans, and you should utilize that because it's just a great way to present it, right? So that's why I say, give me a second here, let me do the math on this for you so I can let you know what that would be. And then if I'm going with a not matching, well, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show them coverages that match. So upgrading one to match the other. Then I'm going to likely, if I upgrade them to say 40,000, but let's just say that realistically, that's still not enough. I would give them the option of just getting them to match. And then I would give them also another couple options of making an upgrade together. So now we match, but we really should be at say 60,000, whatever the case may be. Okay. But matching is the goal because the angle I went in with is matching. And most of the time, at the very least, you're going to get them to match their coverage, even if the other spouse isn't doing any more. Okay. So that's the matching angle. And that, or they have opposite where, you know, the younger person who really should have more, because they're going to live longer, has less coverage, and the older person has more. And you're like, well, what went on with that? Like, you know, we're not going to downgrade your coverage, John, but Mary, we got to get you bumped up because you're going to live 30 more years than John, right? It doesn't make sense. You would have less. We got to get you bumped up there. And speak to a POS like they already understand they need to upgrade, because they should. You know, let me bounce back again. Moving forward, on every presentation that you do, make sure you end it so it would be easy for someone to start it as a POS. And what I mean by that is when you make a sale, congratulate them, make them feel good, make them feel happy. But is it likely that you've ever sold someone so much insurance that they never need to make a change your whole life? Probably not, right? So prep them that you know, within 6 months to a year, you're likely going to get a follow-up from another agent. Could be me, might be another agent servicing your area, and they'll help you at that time to do any upgrades that you need, okay? And then fast forward a year or two down the line, maybe you're an SA, you're a GA, you're an MJ, and someone on your team goes and sees a POS and they say, oh yeah, John told me that someone was going to call me to do an upgrade at some point. This makes sense. It's just easier. So we can all actually help each other out right now today, how we end presentations to make POSs easier for us in a future generation. So that's just my pitch on making it easier for the next generation. Okay. But when you go into a POS, they should expect that they have to do an upgrade, because we're never selling them for their lifetime. If their life changes, they have to make changes. So speak to them as though they already know that they'll probably have to make some upgrades and adjustments down the line, because that should be implicit in the fact that you age and things change, okay? Don't speak to them like if they want to do it. You know, when we tell people, when we ask people, so which way do you want to go in a normal presentation? That's because they don't have anything through us yet, right? I still say, which way do you want to go to a POS, but I'm not saying it like almost like, do you want to? I'm assuming they're going to pick one, because why would you not? You need to make the change to your policy. That's why I'm meeting with you today. Okay. So speak to them assumptively. So the second one is that they have holes or gaps or they're missing coverages. So the way I always approach this one is you never, ever, ever, never, ever want to make it seem like the last agent did something wrong. So don't ever say, oh, why didn't the last agent give you paycheck protection? They must have messed that up. It just kills the integrity of the company. You'll be kicked off POS practically immediately if we find that out, because the company doesn't want the new agents making the old agents or the company look bad, making it sound like they didn't do their job or they forgot, okay? Will there be times in your career you will meet a POS who probably the agent didn't do a great job? Yes, but let's not scare them off from doing business with our company by pointing that out. Let's just fix it. Let's fix it so that we know that when we leave, that's not ever a problem for them again, okay? So make sure you never catch yourself saying things like the last agent got fired or quit, or they did a bad job, or they didn't give you what they need, or they shouldn't have sold you that. Those are just things you got to keep out of your mouth. You don't need to praise an agent who didn't do a good job. But what you do need to do is say, hey, there's some recommendations questions for your policy now, we're going to make sure you're set after this. Okay. And make sure that you're praising the coverages that they do have in place and you're just helping them figure it out. You're not creating a bigger challenge or problem. And if you ever find yourself in a position where a POS is saying they want to cancel their coverage, they're mad, this or that, your job is not to hype them up. Your job is to de-escalate that and help solve whatever the problem is. Okay. You're also going to have policyholders that just do forget what they have. I've had policyholders of my own that have come back years later and told another agent, I told them this, this, and this, and I know I didn't say that, right? So they do forget over time. It happens. It's natural. So again, just remember your job is to be of service, not to create any kind of conflict, and definitely not to cause a conflict with a previous agent, whether or not they do still work here. Doesn't matter, okay? Be the person who you know, deflects and diffuses the situation, not ignites it. Okay. And usually we can leave there with a sale and helping that policyholder feel really good about our company moving forward and making sure they have what they need. Okay. So when you go in for holes and gaps, if I'm going to present missing coverage, I just ask questions. Questions keep you in control rather than saying, hey, they didn't give you paycheck protection. They messed up. I would say, hey, John, so do you remember when you did this originally with whoever the other agent was? Do you remember, did they go over the paycheck protection with you? Because I noticed here, one of the reasons your policy was flagged is it looks like you guys have done a great job of getting your funeral protected, but you didn't have anything set up for your paycheck. Do you remember if they had gone over that with you or not? And if he says, yes, they did, and we didn't want it, okay, now you know. If he says, I'm not sure, I don't remember, say, you know what? It was a long time ago. Your situation might have been different. But again, that is one of the reasons why it's flagged. So I'm going to go over that with you now because that's currently a gap in your coverage, okay? So I'll help you fix it. No problem. Let me go over what that looks like for you. And then just present it to them. You don't have to make them feel like they're bad or missing something and it's negative. Heck, maybe it was their budget back then. Maybe it just wasn't a product we offered. Who knows? But now we are, and I want to make sure you can take advantage of it, okay? And that's how I present holes or missing coverage. And then it's just really easy. If they don't have paycheck protection, ask them, hey, were you not working or you didn't have a family back then? Or like you had no assets to protect? No, we did. We had a kid. Okay, fine. I'm not sure why you didn't have it, but either way, I'll get it fixed for you today and then explain why they need the paycheck protection. If they don't have the A71 for hospital, hey, like, have you ever been in an accident? You ever thought about that? Or maybe you just weren't, you know, you didn't work a dangerous job. I'm not too sure. Could have been a number of things, but let's make sure you have that taken care of today. If they don't have the funeral benefit, hey, John, I know you're not planning on dying anytime soon, but one day you will, right? Yeah, okay. But last time, do you remember, did they go over that funeral benefit for you? Because that's one of the reasons your policy was flagged is you're totally missing your funeral benefit. Did you know that's something that we offered? Yeah, anyways, I won't make you rack your brain too much. Let me go over it with you again, okay? So don't make them think for an hour. Just plant the idea in their head. Did they get shown it or not? And then again, move forward and offer it to them, okay? So that's holes or gaps missing. That one's usually a pretty easy one too, because if they don't have it, give it to them, right? If they don't have it and they need it, they're going to want it. They're already a policyholder. They don't mind paying a little more for stuff that they need, okay? The not inflation-proof one is one that's a little bit trickier, but it's actually a really important one. And this is the one where people buy coverage that might be enough to cover them today, but we know that 10, 20, 30, 40 years from now, that won't be enough money to cover them in the future. It's easier to talk about that when it comes to funeral than it is to paycheck, because we don't know how much their paycheck will be inflated or not. So I usually lean on the funeral benefit. But if I see someone who's 40 and they only have $10,000 worth of coverage, I'm like, hey, John, I'm so glad that you got something, because having something's better than nothing. And heck, maybe you could squeak by with the cremation if you were to die tomorrow, knock on wood, hopefully you don't. But if you're to die 40 years from now, you know, when you're 80, 90, even 100 years old, I'm sure you know $10,000 isn't going to get you far, right? So unfortunately, right now, your program's not inflation-proof, but not to worry. I can probably help you get that fixed. And it is just normal. We have to change things over time. But that being said, has your health changed a whole lot since we did this? Because that could be a problem, right? And hopefully it hasn't. And they tell you that and say, okay, no problem. Let me help you make this inflation proof. So in order to do that, and by the way, if you guys look on our website, there's a great little tool that Chris Smith put together, and it shows projected funeral expenses now and in the future based on how old they're going to be. So you could literally just pull that sheet up and say, you're 40 today. This is how much a funeral is going to cost by the time you die, and then sell them the difference. whatever they need, just sell them the difference. Okay. So it's pretty obvious when they know, and this is where I like to use stories and analogies. You know, it's like gas or a bag of milk. Remember when milk used to be 10 cents for a whole bottle. Now it's like $4, right? So price of gas, remember when gas was 50 cents? Yeah, that was a long time ago. Now it's $2. So costs go up over time. And that's why we need to upgrade our insurance. So even though $10,000 today, knock on wood, might get you by, it's just unrealistic to think that it will 30, 40 years from now, right? Which is why we need to make an upgrade now when you're younger and healthier and it's cheaper. Right? Because the bad thing about insurance is it only gets more expensive and harder to get as you get older. So provided you can still qualify, I'll help you get that taken care of today. No problem. Okay. And we'll make sure that you are inflation proof. So you don't have to do this 3000 times and they'll appreciate that. Okay. So that's the inflation angle. I'm going to save the pay for life plan to very last because it's the more tricky one. But in terms of the, you must have started on the basic plan. That one's kind of easy too. Cause if you see they have really low coverage that looks like, hey, obviously we know HP Pro wouldn't have offered them 2,500 ALP or $2,500 of coverage. They wouldn't have offered them 5,000. HP Pro doesn't show numbers that low, right? So if they pick the plan basic, you can say, so it looks like John, you guys started off on the basic plan back in 2000. Yeah. Okay. Hey, was that just like financial or situation? And they'll probably say, yeah, that's all we could afford at the time. Ask the question, has finances changed for you guys now? Oh yeah, now we work full-time, et cetera. Makes sense, right? This is the same concept as they're only doing 1 hour, not two. Same concept. They either start on the basic plan, basic or the 1 hour versus their full 2 hours. All you need to do to sell a POS there is go back and re-explain how we should be setting aside 2 hours of our weekly wage to protect our loved ones for now and for the future. So John, right now, based on your coverage, you're only at about an hour. So what we'll do today, provided you can qualify, is we'll get you on your full 2 hours and then you'll be properly covered. Sound good? Now, has your health changed a whole lot though since you originally did that? Because that could be a problem. Have that conversation, okay? Let them know you're not just here to sell them more. Okay, you're not just here to sell them more. You're also here to make sure that they have what they need. Okay, so that's important. That's the basic, and then you can get them onto a higher plan. When I'm talking about the on the pay for life plan, this one you want to be really careful with, and you don't want to do this wrong. Okay, it does not have to be an exact science, but here's how it works. So when we sell people insurance, you know that part at the end of the script where we tell them that when they get to retirement age or they get older, they get around 65, they can take a reduced paid up final expense benefit and keep that insurance for the rest of their life. What that really means is say they buy $50,000 today, when they hit 65, they can stop paying, reduce the amount of coverage you're going to take, and it locks in at a lower amount that they can keep forever. But it's not $50,000. Okay, it could drop to 30,000. It could drop to 20,000. It just depends on the age and how much you're taking out. So what you can do is you can look at that number, and if they were excited about having the 50,000, you can still keep them excited about having 50,000 and tell them, hey, John, I just want to make you aware. Were you aware that currently you are on the pay for life plan? And they'll say, well, what's the pay for life plan? I'll say, so our plans have options where you either can either stop paying at retirement or you can pay for the rest of your life. Which would you rather have? They'll say, well, of course we want to stop paying at retirement. Okay. By the way, don't say this to someone who's already a senior. The numbers don't work the same way. So this is for people that are not seniors. They can't do this and stop paying. If they're 60, they can't stop paying at 65 by doing it. This is for people ideally like 45 and under. Okay. And you can get them then. You can sometimes even do it up to 50, but 45 and under. And the easy way to do this, okay, without going and selling different products, we do a product that's called Life Paid Up at 65. There's a better way to do this where the family will actually get more coverage for cheaper than using that program. So this is how I would always do it. I would look at what they have now. If they were excited about getting that 50,000, and I would say, so John, the great part is you can stop paying at 65 when you retire, not as much money is coming in. The challenge is your coverage will end up dropping a little bit. And if they have their policy on them, you can get them to flip to that part of their policy. And it actually shows at the age of 65, how much it drops to. And so you can physically show them, flip to that part of your policy, look at it. So you can see in plain clear numbers that your policy, instead of being 50,000, you don't pay anymore, but now it's 30. Let's just use nice round numbers. Okay. And they'll go, oh geez, but I wanted the 50. Say, no, not to worry. I can still help make sure you have the 50 today and get you onto a pay to 65 plan versus a pay for life plan. Okay. Now it's a little bit more money up front, John, but what it actually means is it's going to secure you double the coverage now. And then when you hit 65, you'll go right back down to 50, maybe even a bit more. And what I do is I sell them double. So if they have 30 now, I would sell them another 30. Okay. Realistically, you could probably sell them less and they could still end up with 30, but just to be safe, I'd rather the client end up with more than less. So if they have 30 now and they want to have 30 at 65, I need to sell them another 30 right now so that at 65, when they stop paying for everything, they're still going to have at least 30. And heck, they might have a pleasant surprise. They might have 40 or 50, depending on the numbers and how old they are when they do this. Okay. But that's what I'm going to tell them. Then you're going to have a minimum of 30. But what that means is we need to double up on your coverage now. The good news about that too, John, is between now and 65, should something happen to you, they're actually going to pay you out the full 60,000. So let's go with the number 30. They already had 30. I sell them another 30. So you're going to get a full 60,000 if anything happens between you now and then. And then once you stop paying at 65, you'll revert back to 30, maybe a little bit more, and you'll have that for the rest of your life. And you'll be able to stop paying altogether. Okay. That's an easy number. That's easy math. And I haven't seen a circumstance where that number doesn't work out. As long as you're not presenting this to people that are like 59, 60, getting into the seniors bracket, because that doesn't, you can't sell someone double the coverage when they're 62 and say, you can stop paying at 65 and you'll have enough. They won't. Okay. So keep that in mind. So if you sell double, that's an easy, easy way to do it. And a lot of the times people are like, yeah, I mean, if I have the extra cash now, why not? Why not throw more into it now, have double the coverage in case anything happens, and then I can stop paying at that age and I still have more money. And if you do the math for them on how much more they're going to pay, this is the cool part. If you do the math, so say you're adding another 30,000 between now and 65, they're not going to pay $30,000 into it, right? So when you do the math with them, they're still going to be in the green no matter what. And again, if you're not a big math person, I'm not either. This is just why I always stick with selling them double, because the math always works out that they actually end up getting more than what they were expecting. They're usually pretty darn happy about that, but they will never pay more into the policy than they're going to receive out of it. So the numbers do make sense. Okay. And if they don't want to, then at least now they know that when they hit 65, that number is not going to be what they originally thought. It's going to drop, and that's totally up to them. But a lot of the time people, they got their mind set on wanting that 30,000. So when you create them a way where they can keep 30 and also stop paying at retirement, that makes way more sense mathematically and logically than just paying for the rest of your life. Because the only other option of say they want to keep the 30 is they have to pay for it forever. Right? So would I rather pay a little bit more now for say the next 20 years or pay for the rest of my life to obtain that amount of money, knowing that, heck, what if I live another 40 years beyond that? I'm going to overpay. Okay. So that's the way the numbers work. And again, that one's a little bit wordy. I would definitely speak to your manager before you go trying that one, just to make sure you fully understand how to present it. And that shouldn't be the instant go-to for everyone. Only use that in those circumstances where these other angles don't make sense. Because if I look at their coverage and they're missing coverage, it's not inflation proof, they have the wrong amounts, I'm gonna tackle that as my angle before I'm going to try to get them on a paid for life plan. Because hey, what's the sense on getting someone off a paid for life plan if they only have $10,000 worth of coverage and they actually need more to begin with? Great. Now you have 10,000 that you can stop paying for at 65, but does that really solve the problem? Not really. They still need more, right? So your job when you're creating an angle is to pick the angle that actually solves the problem the best. So it's a little bit of a problem solving and figuring that part out, but you got to pick the one that solves the problem, not just the one that, you know, that you like, right? It's got to be the one that is going to get them the most bang for their buck, is going to help them the most. And that when they look back, they're going to be really glad that they did that, because it to them, it made them get ahead. Okay. And that hopefully the next person they see, that they see that as a good thing. Geez, they closed one of the gaps. Now they don't need to do that. Right. So those are the angles that you want to take. Now, in terms of a few keywords of the way you want to present this, I already gave you one of my kind of like my bits of ammo, is that you want to make sure you always say the reason your policy was flagged. Okay. The reason I've been given your policy, the reason it's flagged is because ... one of these angles. Let them explain why, and then tackle the angle and present what they need and why you're going to do that. Use the takeaway of, has your health changed at all? Because that could be a problem. And have the, if it has changed, and they can't qualify, congratulate them on the coverage they have. Let them reassure them that that coverage is safe and in place. Get your referrals and end the presentation. Okay. If they can qualify for more, this is when you want to move into using some of these other words. So you want to make sure that when you're doing a POS presentation, just like any other, but specifically on a POS, that it's not you making the recommendation, because it doesn't matter what you think. It matters what the organization, the company, American Income Life, the insurance thinks. So when you're talking to people, make sure you say what they recommend or what they have asked us to tell you, what they recommend you do, or they wanted us to revisit this. You know, one of the things I've used, and this will work for another year or two, and then, it, you know, once COVID is a distant mystery, no one will care anymore. But I've reached out to POSs that I know didn't buy any more coverage during COVID because either they didn't have money, they didn't want to, maybe they couldn't qualify, whatever the case may be. And I've said, hey, based on everything that's kind of going on in the world and with everything that happened with COVID over the past couple of years, they wanted us to revisit this situation with you and see if there is something we can help you out with now. So you can use that one as well. When you're booking a POS that says that they were already seen or that they weren't interested, just say, yeah, no problem. I understand you were just seen 3 months ago, but they wanted us to revisit this with everyone again because of everything that's kind of been going on in the world and changes that have been happening. And you'll still be able to book an appointment. And that's just a reality, okay? So it's always they, what they are allowing you to do. So what they're allowing you to do is to double up on your coverage today to secure your coverage for tomorrow, rather than just having to pay for the rest of your life, okay? They're allowing you to do, it's not things like, well, what you could do is, don't make it a suggestion, make it a, this is the way we do things. The company is allowing you to do this, provided that you qualify, okay? Very, very, very important. So what they recommend is, not what I recommend, what they always do in a circumstance like this is, always lean on the company because the company is so much more powerful than you as an individual. And that way it doesn't seem biased, like it's just your opinion or you want them to buy more. The company wants us to recommend, and they do. That's why they give us the resources to call them, to look at what they have and make recommendations and adjustments. And that's why we have to have an insurance license to do it, okay? But always lean on the company versus what you want them to have or what you think they should have. Lean on the company first. Okay. And one of the things that I love to do is I love to close on the gold, silver, bronze concept. Okay. And it's a really easy concept. HP Pro 3 has made it really easy. You can physically now show three options and you can name them whatever you want. So name one gold, one silver, one bronze. And when I'm presenting it, this is how I make the math work. So the math will be different every time because you're going to service different people with different amounts of coverage. But in terms of gold, silver, bronze, the way it works is the gold program will be a program that I designed that will always be enough to cover them from now until the end of time. So say we're talking about the gold program, it's got enough paycheck protection. It's got a full funeral benefit that even if they live to be 120, it's enough. It covers everything forever. That's gold. Okay. Silver, it's more of taking cover or taking care of things for today's costs and a bit down the line. So making sure that they're definitely good at today's costs. They have enough to cover themselves now and maybe 10, 20 years into the future. But yeah, if you live to be 90, will it cover you? Maybe not, right? And you can also cater the silver program to whether they want burial or cremation. So if they want a cremation, you can cater it to being enough for that. If they want a burial, enough for that, okay? For now, for the foreseeable future. And if things change in your life, let me know. And then the bronze program, that to me, that is basically what they need today, no matter what, okay? Or a 50% deposit for what they need down the line. So if they say, hey, I want a full burial and they only have 10,000 today, that is not going to cut it. That is not going to cut it. So my bronze program would be at least a 50% deposit toward the full burial down the line. And I'll tell them that, hey, all that does, guys, at the very least, you've got to be at the bronze program, because at the very least, if you decide to go full burial, this should cover the deposit. And that'll at least buy you a little bit of time to figure out where you're getting the rest, or it'll probably cover a full cremation for you. Okay. So that's normally how I set up the bronze. And then anything below that, you're not properly covered. The bronze level, if you sell someone a bronze, you should leave that presentation comfortably knowing that they actually do have a good enough level of coverage today. If they're not at least at bronze, they are not properly covered. Okay. Now, what if you meet someone and in your opinion, they are at bronze? that's totally fine. You can tell right now, John, you're kind of at the bronze level. They recommend being at the silver or gold. I mean, we'd love you to be at gold, be covered till the end of time, but we've at least got to get you to silver. Does that make sense? And most of the time, this language resonates with people. Nobody wants to be below bronze. That's why POS is closed on such a high level, because nobody wants to be improperly covered, right? So at the very least, they're going to get to bronze. Usually they pick the silver from experience. And if they really just want to hammer it home and they just want to get this done, they don't want to have to meet with people again and again and again and keep having this conversation, then they're going to go for the gold. Okay. So present it that way and just make sure your numbers match up. And when I do that, if they are below the bronze, I would say, hey, John, so the challenge with your program now is, as you can see, you're just a little bit below the bronze level. Right? Because right now you don't have enough to even cover you really at today's cost, and definitely not even 10, 15 years into the future. So my goal today is, if you qualify, we'll get you to at least bronze. Obviously they prefer to recommend silver or gold, but which way did you want to go today? And they'll pick one. It doesn't have to be a long drawn out close. Which way do you want to go? And they're going to pick a program. Okay. And then you're going to close on that one. And it doesn't matter which one they pick. A lot of the times they'll look at each other, if it's spouses, and they'll go, well, I don't want to be at bronze. Do you want to do gold or do you want to do silver? And they'll ask you the same thing. If we do the silver, can we upgrade down the line? Be honest. Yes, you can, as long as you're still healthy. But just remember, the price today won't be the price 2 years from now. So the gold won't, the gold will be the platinum in 2 years, right? So it's going to go up, as long as you guys are okay with that. And if you can stretch your budget a bit, and if you're thinking you might want more and you can stretch your budget, it is better to do it now. And just be honest with them. Be honest. You don't have to go into POS as worried that they can't afford it. Okay. You don't have to go into POS as worried that, oh gosh, that they're already paying $60. There's no way they'll pay 60 more. Yes, they will, guys, because they'll realize that if they're only paying $60 now, they're getting a deal. The average family doesn't pay $60 for insurance. So if they have to pay another 60 to make it 120, that's still pretty darn cheap. That's still pretty cheap. So don't go into POS as trying to top them up by 10 or 15 bucks. Top them up by what they really need. That's called service. When you're going in and you're topping someone up by $12, I don't mean to be rude, but you're not helping them. You're wasting their time and you're wasting your time. Okay. So don't do that. Go in and top people up for the amount of coverage that they need. And if they don't want to do it or they can't, that's okay. But I don't buy it when I see POS top-ups for 112 ALP and it's not a head start. Like, are you telling me they needed that extra, $200 of coverage? No, they didn't. They didn't need it. They needed an extra 5,000. So don't be shy at showing them what they need. It's totally fine. And that's why you'll see some people, and many of you on this call right now, come out with big POS top-ups, and other people seem to be always getting these 80 ALP, 120 ALP. Why? Because you're psyching yourself out thinking that I don't want to show them too much because they're already paying so much. Guys, wouldn't you prefer to know the truth about what you need, even if it costs more? Clients are smart. They can tell you yes or no, but don't let it be the reason that because you're going and under showing them. And if they do say, well, I'm already paying $60, I'm already paying $100. Now you want me to pay $100 more? Then say to them, well, hey, John, I'm just showing you what you need. The reason you were only paying $100 before is because you were 25 years old when you took it out. Now you're 50, right? Guess what's going to happen when you're 70? It just goes up in price. So the reality is the numbers don't really matter. You do need the extra $50. It's up to you if you want to do it. And again, you have to qualify, but my job is to show you what you need. I don't want this to be a thing where someone comes back and sees you two, three years from now and finds out I didn't do my job because I wasn't honest with you, right? So did you want to do the gold, the silver, or the bronze? Which way do you want to go? Rationalize with people. Don't be scared to show big programs. If there's a reason behind it and it makes, don't show a big program if they don't need it, but if they do, show it. And be honest with them. They'll appreciate that about you. And whether or not they choose to do anything about it, it's way more likely that they'll make a buying decision to buy something from you that day if you're honest. Versus like, well, we could top you up by $5. No one needs $5 more of insurance. Okay. They just don't. Don't kid yourself. They don't need it. Okay. Unless you're doing head starts for the kids, in which case, need I remind you, a head start for a kid is not more important than an upgrade for an adult. I'll just put this out there because yes, we're protecting the kids, but when the parents die, what happens? The kids still have to pay. So you should always prioritize income on getting the parents upgraded first before you start adding head starts, cancer plans, all this other jazz. The parents should be set first and then add it on. If the parent is not going to buy anything and they say, I will not do it, sure, do the head start for the kid. But that should be the only time you come out with a parent underinsured and a kid with insurance, just to put that out there. Okay. All right. So you're showing gold, silver, bronze. It's really direct. It's really honest. And in my experience, you close POS the best when you're having just an honest conversation about it. And the most common things you're going to hear are, I think we're okay for now, or we'll just see what happens. Right? Yeah, I think we're good where we are. And just remember, it is your job. It's your duty to be honest with these people. You wouldn't be telling them they needed more insurance or they didn't. So when someone throws you a line like, I'm okay for now, or I think we'll just leave it as is, just understand that's just their way of brushing you off because they don't really want to spend the money, but maybe they just don't understand how important this is. Because if that person knew they were going to die a year from now, I promise you they would do it today. But nobody thinks they're ever going to die. So feel free to call them out per se, not in a rude way, but call them out and say, hey, John, what do you mean by you're okay for now? Like, what did you mean by that, right? Hey, John, what did you mean by like, you know, you'll just see what happens. Say, can I just be honest with you? And this is one of my lines. You can write it. Can I just be honest with you? Is it okay if I'm just blunt? You're not going to be mad? Say, John, what do you mean we're going to wait and see what happens? What's going to happen is you're going to get older, less insurable. The price is going to go up and one day you're going to die like everyone else. So all that's going to happen is one day when you die, your family's not going to have what they need. That's it. Nothing's going to change unless you plan to win the lottery, right? So I'm just being honest. Maybe it's not what you want to hear, but it is the truth, right? So you don't have to make an upgrade, but if you don't, I just want to be honest with you. You are leaving a gap in your coverage, and that $10,000 you have, it will not be enough to cover you when you die. And your family will have to find another way to come up with this money. Are you following what I'm saying here? And have a rational conversation with John. Okay. When you rationalize things, people get out of the zone of thinking you're just trying to sell them, and they understand like there's logic to this. Like, does that make sense just to wait and see what happens? No. Does it make sense to wait till I'm older to apply for more? No, because it gets more expensive and you might not qualify. It's not a threat. It's the truth. And I've even asked people, could you stretch your budget to make this work now? Because hey, if this is taking food off the table and you absolutely can't afford another penny, it sucks because you do need more, but it is what it is. But if there was a way to budget for it, don't you think it would make more sense now to set aside that 2-3 extra bucks a day now versus having to leave your family to figure out an extra 20 grand down the line? Because I don't know about you, but if something happened to my mom tomorrow and I just pull 20 grand out of the bank, that seems like a lot harder of a thing to do than setting aside $3 a day. Are you following what I'm saying? And they'll go, yeah, yeah. That's how you close people, guys. It's by using the emotion to get to a logical place. Do they want to leave this for their kids? No. Do they want to leave this for their spouse? No. But you can't close on emotion. You close on logic. What is easier? Stop drinking 3 Tim Hortons coffees a day and save that $3. Okay. Or have your child put out $20,000 when you die. Either way, someone's paying. It's either you now or it's them down the line. And waiting doesn't make sense, because if you don't want to pay for it now, it's only going to get worse as you get older. And you might get to a point where you can't get it at all. And that's why they have people like me having this conversation with you, John, right? Be honest, be genuine, be authentic with people. Don't go trying to close them. They should close. It's common sense. It's common sense. And isn't it also common sense if they don't have 2 pennies to rub together and they don't have any money? Well, how could they buy more? Right? So I'm not going to pressure someone to buy more that literally has no money and is almost lapsing on their first policy. But if they have some money, they have some savings, they have jobs, they're working, they can afford it. It's just a matter of helping them prioritize for what they need. Okay. So the most important thing when going in with a POS is going in with a purpose, remembering it's service first, picking the right angle. Because if you just go in trying to sell more insurance but for no reason, they're going to figure that out really quickly. And they're going to go, well, why would I want more? I already have lots of insurance, or we're good. And they'll brush you off real quick. But if you go in with a logical angle and you articulate that angle to them and you can make it make sense to them as to why they would need more, they probably will buy. And then all you have to do is get the numbers. So one little trick I use when I'm getting the numbers is I'll say, okay, John, bear with me a minute here. Math is not my strong suit. Talk amongst yourselves. It's going to give me a minute to pull the numbers together. I want to show you what those options would look like for us to bring you up to the level you need to be at. Okay. So bear with me a minute. And then I just go about my business. I fix the numbers. I figure out what the numbers are. And again, you guys can use HP Pro to figure that out and put the numbers in the needs analysis to figure out how much they need. You can use that sheet on our website that I talked about that projects their funeral. You can use common sense if you'd like after you've been here for a little bit, and you can go, geez, okay, well, Mary's 20 and she only has 5,000 of coverage. That's not nearly enough. Heck, anything you sell them will be better than that, right? And you can figure this out down the line, and you can revert back to, what did you sell your last client that was 50? What did you sell your last client that was 25? right? You can do the math. If you need to sell them paycheck protection, you can do the math. Ask them, how much is your annual income? 50 grand. Okay. 50 grand times 3 years is how much? And then do the difference on the math. So you can figure this all out. Do it quickly. If you're really good and you have POS presentations booked for the next day, look on your HP Pro after hours that night, do some quick math and figure out what you're going to show them. So when it comes presentation time, it doesn't seem like it's all over the place. But again, you don't need that long to figure this out. Once you get familiar with HP Pro, you can pull these numbers up pretty quickly and present it to them as the gold, silver, bronze, right? And again, it's not going to be the same numbers every time. So I don't want to say gold is 50,000 to 75, silver. It's not like that. It's based on what they need based on their age. Okay. And based on their situation, if someone says, I only want to do a cremation, their gold would be probably different than someone that wanted a full burial. I would still be apt to make it a little more than a cremation because heck, they might change their mind down the line. Their kids might decide to bury them instead of cremate them. So that's up to you to use your discretion. But at the same time, just understand what the gold, silver, bronze really, what it signifies, and then make sure the numbers match up. And when you're presenting the program, make sure you say, this is a silver program that covers you for dot, 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 and it's this much coverage so that they know what that is, okay? And then they just pick one. So now that you understand gold, silver, bronze, John, which one do you want to do? Which way do you want to go? And most of the time, they're going to pick one or the other. And the odd time, they're going to say they don't want to make any changes. And that's when you got to have an honest moment with your client. And if they need it, you need to find a way to make them understand that. And if they still don't want to, I've left presentations before saying, John and Mary, I just want to be clear. You guys fully understand you are not fully covered. You are not properly covered today. And that unfortunately, that you may not qualify down the line or it's going to cost more money. And as of right now, knock on wood, if you were to die tomorrow, there is not enough money to cover your funeral. You guys understand that? And if they say, yep, we're happy with that, I'll go, okay, hey, I don't get that too often, but it's totally up to you, right? And then I just carry on. Like, I'm not going to force them. But at the same time, I want to make sure they understand the implications of their decision one way or the other. And they don't leave here thinking that they're good when they're not good. People sometimes will say, we're good. Don't let them leave saying we're good. Say, well, what do you mean by we're good? Like, you have enough money? Like, what do you mean? Figure that out, because that's just a way for people to brush things off to not have to make a decision. But it's not always that they are actually good. And I've closed tons and tons and tons of sales, POSs, McGraths, unions, referrals, doesn't matter, by being that honest with them. And don't let them get away with the we're good, I think we'll wait, we'll see what happens. Be a little funny. What's going to happen? You're going to get older and die, and there's not going to be enough coverage for to be blunt. That's what's going to happen, right? Why do you think that they have insurance, John? We don't have insurance because we like it. We have it because we need it. Heck, I don't want to pay either, but I do because I know I need to. That's the way you have to talk to people. Closing is not about being fake. It's not about saying the perfect thing. It's about being authentic and being real and talking to people like they're your mom or they're your dad, and like they've got a clock over their head with a countdown that says they're going to die tomorrow, and it's your job to help them today, but you can't tell them they're going to die tomorrow. If you knew that about someone you love deeply, that they were going to die tomorrow, and this is your only shot to help them, how would you treat them? But you can't tell them. But you got to find a way to treat them. It's like charades, right? You got to say the word without saying the word. You would find a way to get your message across. Do that the same way, because everyone you meet is someone's mom, dad, brother, sister, neighbor, friend, cousin. They're somebody to somebody. And that's how you're going to close a lot of sales here, is by treating them like they're that important to you. Okay. And again, not to get like over the top about being emotionally connected, but you know, people do appreciate that. And if I've ever crossed a line, which I probably have, but I've ever crossed the line where I came across as pushy or aggressive, that's the way I've always gotten back across that line to happy, is I've said to them, hey, I'm sorry, John, I didn't mean to push you. It's just that I take my job really seriously. And I meet people all the time that aren't covered. I process death claims. I look at you like you're my mom, my dad, my brother, my sister, my cousin. And I just want to make sure we do what's best for you. So my apologies if I crossed the line, certainly didn't mean to. And half the time they apologize to you and then they buy the insurance because they realize you're being genuine, right? So trust me, being real and authentic counts. It makes a really big difference, okay? But my training today was on your POS angles, gold, silver, bronze. The most important part you can do when you do the gold, silver, bronze is be very clear on the numbers and make sure that they always know it's in addition to what they're already paying. It doesn't replace it. It's in addition. And then a tip I will give you on when you present the dollars is I always, always, always do it in dollars a day. So if it's $60 a month, hey, John, it's only an additional $2 a day. It's $90 a month. It's only an additional $3 a day. You can do the math and you can go up pretty quickly. It sounds so, and then I'll give you my extra tip. Not only do I say that, if it starts to get high, like say it's an extra $5 a day, I'll go, it's like a, you know, it's like a Starbucks coffee and a feta wrap. I don't know if you guys have ever eaten those, right? So you cut back on one of those, you pay for your insurance. Give them something they can relate it to so it doesn't seem like such a big deal, right? Rather than saying it's an extra $60, what sounds better to you? If you're paying $60 right now, you're already paying $60. And I come to you and I say, John, it's going to be an additional $60, double what you're paying now to a total of 120. That sounds scary. What if I come and say, hey, John, the great news is it's only an additional $2 a day, which is basically like the equivalent of a Tim Hortons coffee and a donut. And that fully covers you. Doesn't that sound a little nicer? Right? They still need to know it's $60 a month, $2 a day, $60 a month, $120 total. They still can do the mental math and come to you and say, well, isn't that double what I'm paying? They might still do that, but it just sounds easier because realistically it's not that unmanageable. It is only $2. It is only a Tim Hortons coffee and a donut. It is only a Dunkin' Donuts if you're from the US. It is only that. It's not a big deal, right? So make sure people know that and give them the numbers. That's going to avoid them making that comparison to how much more it is that they're all, or saying I'm already paying this much. Okay. We have a couple minutes here. So I'll take a few of your questions. If you guys have got any questions now, feel free to throw some in the chat and I'll address those. But I do want to go over one more thing. So in any presentation, and specifically in POSs, it's always important that you give a relation to something. So whenever you have a client that says, I already have a lot of insurance, or I'm already paying too much, or I don't want to pay anymore, or I don't think I need that, you've got to make comparisons to things that are real life. Just like I did with the coffee being $2. It's hard to say no to a, like, could you set aside a coffee a day? I know you're already doing it, John. I know you're doing it. He's like, yeah. Okay. Set aside a coffee for this because you need to, right? But I also use analogies like when people say that they don't want to pay more or they already have stuff. I'll make it realistic. I'll say, yeah, hey, I get it. You do have a lot of insurance. You have $2 million through Sun Life. That is a lot of insurance, John. But that being said, that's a lot of temporary insurance. So is it fair to say that you're not trying to die young, right? You're not trying to die young. Okay. Even if they have whole life, let's say they have whole life. Perfect. They have 2 million of Sun Life term. They have 100,000 of whole life insurance. Wow. How do you sell anyone like that? I'll say, John, but you don't have a funeral benefit, or your funeral benefit's not up to date. And I'll make an analogy. I'll say, just because you have a shirt, it's like, hey, I got a shirt. I got a long sleeve shirt for the summer. Doesn't mean I don't need it. Or a long sleeve shirt for the winter. Doesn't mean I don't need a t-shirt for the summer. Right. So it's great that you have what you have. You have your term insurance there to cover you if you die young, cover debts, et cetera. You have your whole life to cover the real debts when you die or to leave legacy money, but you still need something to cover your funeral because that's what this one is for. Right. So make sure you connect things. Like, is one shirt enough? No. Right. That's like saying like, hey, you guys, you have lots of oranges. Just make lemonade. I need a lemon to make lemonade. I can have 10,000 oranges. Does that help me make lemonade? No. So don't get intimidated when people say I have a lot of insurance. You have a lot of insurance that's not American Income Life Insurance, right? You have a lot of insurance that's not for your funeral. You have a lot of insurance that's not for your paycheck. You have a lot of insurance that's not through me, the best damn life insurance agent that you ever met. You have a lot of that stuff, but you don't have this. And make sure to know they know that. Some of you guys are smiling because you're feeling funny and good. So will your clients when you talk to them like this. Talk to them like this. Guys, I had a client walk me out. He said no like 100 times. And he was saying no and it made no sense because he really needed it. So I kept going back and forth. And when we left, he walked me to my car. I didn't know if he wanted to slam the door on me or what. He bought it. And he says, Megan, thank you for persuading my family. I got to be honest, I felt a little weird that he said that. I was like, oh, I didn't mean to persuade you, John. He's like, no, you did. And you needed to, because you're right. And I needed it. So thank you. And I was like, you're welcome. It was such a weird thing. But that's how he felt. I really needed to twist the guy's arm. But I wasn't doing it out of disrespect or pushing it or to make money. Heck, I probably lost money because I missed my next two appointments. I had to reschedule them trying to get this guy to buy this. But he needed it. Their family needed it. Like, they were at a point in time in their life where they were so undercovered and they just weren't thinking right. They weren't planning for the future. And I realized that this guy was so difficult that if not me, who is ever going to get this family protected? Because no one else is going to put up with this guy for 2 hours arguing with you. It's not going to happen. It's me or probably nobody. So I took it like, if this was my grandpa or my dad or someone that I wanted to make sure really got what would I say or do? Would I push a little harder? Yes. At the end of the day, they were glad they got it covered. We worked through all the conversations enough to get to a point where it made sense, and he was glad that we did it. So have some fun with your clients. Laugh with them. Be blunt with them. Be honest with them. Shake them up a little bit if you need to. You can always apologize, okay? But treat them like you're the only shot they've got at getting this done. And if they were your mother, sister, brother, dad, cousin, friend, whoever they were to you, and if they did die tomorrow, wouldn't you hope that the guy or gal who met them the day before to sell them life insurance did everything they could to get that enforced? That's the way you got to think. Okay. And that's how you're going to sell more insurance to POSs, to referrals, to unions, to McGruffs. That's how you're going to sell more insurance to everyone. And that is when you're going to start to love this business. That's when you're going to one day wake up and go, gosh, this is easy. Why? Because you're just out there giving it your all every day and somehow you're getting paid. That's when you're going to start to really love this business. Okay. So put your heart into it. So that's my training for today on POS. That's everything I have to go over. If you guys have any other questions, throw them in the chat. I'll take a minute or two to go over them. If you don't, you are free to go. I hope you guys have an absolutely amazing day. Close up lots of sales and use these little tips in all your presentations. And especially when you guys see a POS. Okay. Have a good day and bye for now.